Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station, by other public television stations, and by the following.
It has not been widely noticed that the third largest political party in the United States is the Libertarian Party, which in the last election took 1% of the vote and here and there elected someone to something, its slates appearing in all 50 states of the Union. Its presidential candidate was Ed Childs of California, and more nearly so than any other political party save possibly the Communist Party. It is, in fact, the instrument of a collection of thinkers. They call themselves libertarians, by which term is generally meant the primacy of individual freedom over any other considerations. We have here to discuss the movement and its philosophy, if not the dominant figure in the libertarian movement, he would, by general agreement, be Murray Rothbard, but one of its principal voices. Tibor Machan carefully distinguishes between his own views and that of the Libertarian Party, as I expect we shall see. But Mr. McCann forcefully urges his own political philosophy, and in a libertarian world, one is free to say of it that it is quintessentially libertarianism. Tibor McCann was born in Hungary and as a child was smuggled to Austria. At age 17, he came to the United States. He served in the Air Force, got a BA degree from Claremont Men's College, and an MA in philosophy from the New York University, and his PhD in philosophy from the University of California in Santa Barbara. There, at this time, he serves as a visiting associate professor in economics, acting also as senior editor of Reason magazine and as head of the educational activities of the Reason Foundation. His book, which will come out later on this month, is a compilation of libertarian essays entitled The Libertarian Reader, which will be published by Roman and Littlefield. Our examiner, whom is sympathetic but stern critic of the libertarian movement, is Professor Ernest Vandenhaag, about whom more in due course. I'd like to ask Mr. McCann, before we become airborne in philosophy, to spend a few minutes on the movement. What are its plans at the moment, its political strengths during the Reagan administration?
Let me first say that it was Ed Clark who was the presidential candidate and not Ed Childs. Roy Childs is one of the activists in the movement, but Ed Clark is the one who ran for president. I am not very familiar with the inner workings of the party itself. The movement is a collection of various people, academicians, ordinary citizens, pundits, magazine writers, and so on, from a variety of philosophical perspectives. That's one of the interesting things about libertarianism, is that people can be utilitarians, they can be Christians, they can be Randian objectivists, and so on, but the conclusion in the political arena that they arrive at is that liberty is indeed the prime social or political value, not necessarily the prime human value. So to make a comment, a generalization about almost anything else concerning libertarians is almost impossible because they are united only on this one thing and not very well even on that. But beyond that, the movement is trying to flourish to some extent. It's trying very hard to distinguish itself from the Reagan landslide or the Reagan constituency by being in domestic affairs and with respect to the free market more principled, in fact, purist, if you want to know. And it's very dissatisfied with the resignation of Martin Anderson and Paul Craig Roberts and people like that from the Reagan entourage. And it is some of its members are close enough to the Washington establishment to exert some influence, for example, in this fight for gold standard and something along those lines. Milton Friedman, who is by many of us regarded as at least libertarian in many respects, is listened to and respected. And there are quite a few other people like Carl Brunner from Rochester, who in many respects fit within a libertarian mold, but not fully. The same thing is true of F.A. Hayek, who's exerting some influence in economics. And they're not purists in the sense in which Murray and I would regard ourselves purists, although even we disagree. But there is something of a hopefulness in the libertarian movement because the people are looking for an alternative to statism as they understand it, maybe not consciously, maybe not deliberately, but they seem to be more receptive to ideas that stress freedom rather than redistribution of wealth, rather than government solution to problems.
Well, I read a while ago that there was some dissension within the party as to whether an appeal ought to be taken to the Federal Communications Commission against a ruling by one of the networks that they did not need to give the candidate equal time. The dissension was on whether it was in some way corrupting to utilize the mechanisms of political society even in order to achieve within the rules of that society some kind of equity. Did you participate in that quarrel or observe it?
A little bit I did. I was asked to sign some sort of a letter at one time, and I did object to going to the FCC myself. I'm not necessarily in principle always opposed to utilizing the mechanism that the state makes available for achieving certain ends. When things are as muddied as they are today, I don't think one can be terribly principled on every front because it's impossible. So, yes, I did take a side. I didn't think that was a good move. On the other hand, I don't think it's a major point of debate. I think that lots of times in these kinds of debates, personality issues come in that tend to muddy the waters even further. But it is not a good idea, I think, to go and ask the state to settle these kinds of things. However, on the other side, I must admit that because the state is the owner of the airways, I mean, there is no such thing as private ownership of television and broadcast media. There is a rental system going on. The federal government nationalized the broadcast media in 1927. And so it is the arbiter about these matters. And if you don't go to them, there's nowhere else to go to handle the situation.
Yeah.
So they have a point, and it's not a clear-cut issue one way or the other.
Now, it has been said about the Libertarian Party that it is dominated by the Koch Foundation.
It's the Koch.
It's Koch, sorry. By the Koch Foundation, whose opposition to militarism in effect invites the demilitarization unilaterally of America. Is this a live issue within the Libertarian Party?
It is a live issue, a Libertarian Party and the movement, mostly also in the movement. It is a serious issue, both for reasons of the political efficacy of the movement and also because there are some serious questions that arise as to how a free country ought to defend itself against threats and what constitutes a threat of a free society, whether, for example, going to El Salvador constitutes a defensive measure or an intrusion into the sovereignty of another country.
Let's not get into that. We can in due course if you want. But I simply want to find out the extent to which an observer could reasonably conclude that support given to the Libertarian Party is support given to a party that would urge the demilitarization of America to the point of making it an easy victim of the Soviet Union.
I would have to concede the following, that as far as the party hierarchy is concerned, the people who are in control right now are far more isolationistic than would be desirable from my perspective, and I would say the majority of the members of the movement, if you can call them members, by all accounts of the little bit of poll-taking that has been going on at the various conventions, it looks like that about 60% to 70% of the constituency of the party is pretty much for an adequate defense, as they call it. That is, for a strong military to defend the United States against any kind of a potential aggressor. But the money for the party has tended to come from the Koch group. Now the Koch group, for very, I think, honest philosophical reasons of their own, believes that this has been a mistake and they are sort of in the Taft, or what they consider to be the Taft tradition of isolationism, George Washington's a farewell message and all of that, and they believe that military excursions and so forth are bad for the United States and compromise our claim to being a free country and so on, and have gotten us into a lot of trouble. And so they have exerted their power through money and through the personnel that they have managed to collect around themselves to make that the party's message. But that's not the message of the constituency of the party.
Are any conclusions to be drawn from the collapse of the their principal journal?
I can't tell you that. I just don't know. I'm not that closely involved. I'm mainly in the think tank area, and when it comes to this sort of thing, if you don't know yourself through the maze of gossip and all of this stuff, then you might as well just not be terribly closely involved.
Okay. Well, let's take then the question of the American libertarian and ask ourselves some questions about it. What are the means of effecting the national defense that are sanctioned by the libertarian philosophy?
Well, the answer has to be something like what I think that libertarian philosophy would say about this thing, because, as I say, there are a number of different people. David Friedman has different things to say, although he calls himself a libertarian. But I think that the answer is that if there were a libertarian revolution, whether it be legal or some other way it came about through repeal of laws and so on, the only avenue for bringing off the adequate defense of the country would be through the levying of fees for the services that the government offers. Now, the services that the government offers are quite large, despite the fact that the libertarian calls for the total elimination of the welfare state, whether it's for big business or for welfare mothers or whatever. And this service would be essentially the upholding of contracts and the integrity of contractual relations throughout the entire country. Contract and crime prevention would be the business of the government. For this, the government could levy fees at any time that a contract is written. Now, there are multi-billion dollar contracts made every moment of the day. Long-term ones, short-term ones.
The fee would be a percentage of that contract?
That's right. Uh-huh. Whatever the market would bear, in a sense. Now, that's not necessarily what everyone might answer to this question that you ask, but that's the best answer that I can offer at the present time. There would be other emergency measures that one could take. Lotteries could be instituted by the government, as long as they do not exert coercion upon those who are to pay the fees. This would be perfectly legitimate. Any voluntary means would be legitimate, and any transactional means that involve trade and the service delivered would be legitimate.
Well, let's take Mrs. Jones, who works as a seamstress. In what way would your mechanisms provide for any contribution by her to the national defense, without which she wouldn't be able to work freely as a seamstress?
Well, there are all sorts of business involvements that Mrs. Jones would probably have. She would probably purchase goods, and she would sell her services, and she would pay for electricity bills, and she would pay for gas bills, and she would pay for rent, and lots of other things. And many of these involve short and long-term contracts. And to the extent that she's interested in being protected in the integrity of these contracts, mm-hmm. such that in case some default occurs, either on the other party's part, or some of us want to protect our traders against our own default, we would then need the services at some point of a court or even an enforcement agency like the police. Mm-hmm. And there would be fees that would be attached to this.
So that, let's say, the electrical company in its contract with her would lay off on her some of the cost that it's contributing in order to secure the protections of the state, is that it?
Something like that,
yeah.
Something along those lines. You know, the problem with the libertarian public finance issue is that so many of us had to defend sort of the foundations of the system, that the details, the permutations, do not get worked out in the various journals of public finance that are published in America and the foreign, in the forums of this kind of discussion. It's very difficult for us to get to that because people are still haranguing us about that freedom is really such a great value. Mm-hmm. So we are always working mostly at that level, whereas everyone else who is into Marxism and into the welfare state and into the various alternative political doctrines has had the opportunity to work out some of these things in detail, test them in the discussion forums. We haven't had that. So I give you these answers rather by winging them as opposed to going to a book in which this is discussed in great detail.
Mm-hmm. Well, do you think that Ayn Rand, for instance, would have answered the question I put to you differently?
No.
You don't. So therefore, the idea is to let me quote a sentence from one of your essays. The key to this idea is that a libertarian government would provide crucial yet unique private goods as well as public goods, and this would make it possible to secure the financing of government voluntarily. Mm-hmm. But what if the seamstress said, I don't want to pay this tax? Is there any way in which the government could withdraw this unique service?
Well, it's not a tax. It's a fee. That's what I want to distinguish it from a tax.
Well, you want to distinguish it, but I'm not sure you can succeed.
Well, it's because the seamstress
could. It seems to be a tax.
Well, because
you can't be a seamstress unless you do X, right?
Well, no, I wouldn't say that because, in fact, such a society would allow trade on the basis of a handshake. It wouldn't be a very wise way of trading sometimes. It wouldn't be very prudent. But it would allow for it. And so your what-if question is perfectly legitimate. It could turn out in principle that everybody does trade by simply shaking hands. If everybody is very trustworthy and everybody is very competent and nature doesn't interfere in very catastrophic ways, these kinds of things could go on. And then we would live in a utopia and we wouldn't need a government anyway and the question would be irrelevant in some sense.
Yeah.
I cannot guarantee anything with a libertarian political philosophy because it is a philosophy that is predicated on the notion that people have to will to do some things, and if they won't do that, then things fall apart. But I challenge anyone to provide any other alternative system which isn't in some way predicated on that same assumption. So the question is, given that nothing is guaranteed at all in any kind of a political system, given that, which of those systems does better? And I think the libertarian system does better.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's take some planks then from the Libertarian Party's last program and see which of them, I assume you agree with all of them, but let's take some rather provocative ones. Abolish the FBI. Are you in favor of abolishing the FBI?
You assume that I agree with all of them, but I should correct you. I don't necessarily agree with all of them. The party is a amalgamation of various opinions and the results of the platform.
Since you're here as an accredited spokesman for the libertarian philosophy, perhaps you can explain to us why that should be one of the programs articulated by the party.
Okay, well, I can give you an answer as to why I think that many libertarians object to some of the practices and some of the policies of the FBI, partly because...
Well, everybody does.
Well, that's right, but I'm going to give you the reasons why the libertarians do, not...
Well, I'm talking about the existence of the FBI.
Oh, that's right. Well, it's partly because some libertarians, and I'm not sure if I'd include myself in them, among them, maintain that it is inherent in the existence of such an institution as the FBI to practice things that are in violation of basic human rights. For example, procedural rights that arise in the way in which criminals are tracked down and apprehended and arrested and so on. And I don't happen to agree with that. Now, I don't know whether the Federal Bureau of Investigation is indeed constitutionally such that it would violate libertarian principles. I doubt that, seriously.
Okay. What about abolishing the CIA? They want to do that too.
Again, here is something that I find questionable. I don't know whether the CIA is such inherently as to violate libertarian principles. Mm-hmm. A spy organization certainly doesn't need to be that way, in my opinion. And as a result, I am not in full agreement with that with that provision.
Now, they say that the military should be limited to defending the United States and go on to specify that the military should all be contained within the borders of the United States, but those two, of course, are not necessarily compatible, are they?
I agree with you, and I think that's a wrong way of putting that, and I think that's just a mistake.
Uh-huh. Now, they believe in abolishing all drug laws.
That I agree with.
That you agree with. they believe that taxes, quote, are a kind of legalized theft, which can and should be abolished as soon as possible.
Yes, that I agree with.
Then we get into that terminological problem. Well, now, what, if any, are the distinctive contributions to the thought of your philosophy made by Robert Nozick in his famous book?
Basically, Anarchy, State, and Utopia presents a certain kind of argument for libertarian conclusions which has not been around. It's called the argument for best explanation. Mm-hmm. It combines a certain methodological device in contemporary philosophy called intuitionism with some other things that are going on in the philosophy of science, saying something like this: given certain assumptions that human beings have individual rights, and given these intuitions that we have, moral intuitions, which means certain basic moral beliefs that we carry around within ourselves, wouldn't a system that would arise from the adherence to these basic assumptions coincide with these basic intuitions? And Nozick says, yes, it would. Therefore, we could have a totally libertarian society and meet the fundamental moral requirements that philosophy has sort of thrown up in the last 20 years that have to be met in a political system of justice. Nozick, incidentally, doesn't believe that clinches the argument for libertarianism per se. He, however, maintains that, and he's maintained that to me personally, that this sends everybody back to the drawing board, mm-hmm. especially Rawls and Dworkin.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, the advantage of intuitionism is therefore that that which you assert does not require a scaffolding of arguments, right?
That's right.
So you don't have the social contract.
That's right.
So there are therefore no political acts, the intertwining of which caused a certain situation. Rather, it comes more or less ex nihilo.
Well, I'm not sure whether it comes ex nihilo. Maybe they would invoke psychology or cultural anthropology or something. I do know that Rawls wrote a piece for the Eastern Division of the American Philosophical Association called The Independence of Moral Theory, in which he argued that we don't need epistemology, we don't need metaphysics, we don't need philosophy of mind, we just need these considered moral judgments on which to rest our institutions and our practices and our law.
Considered.
Considered.
Now, is that the operative word?
That's the operative word. It has to be put into an equilibrium. It has to be consistent. It's Kantian in that respect.
Yeah, yeah.
It has to somehow coincide.
But must it flow from discourse, or is it supposed to simply reside there and become instantly discoverable?
I don't know. Frankly, I'm not an intuitionist, so I'm not going to try to defend them very much. I don't really know. I think Rawls, in his book, A Theory of Justice, maintains that the intuitions really do arise out of a person-to-person conversation sometimes. That is, between you and me, we would agree that certain things, like a big man beating up on a little girl, is just wrong, and there's no need to theorize about that. We just know that.
Well, that would be an insight as distinguished from an intuition, wouldn't it?
Well, I think that's the same thing in that vocabulary. An intuition is a sort of a immediate recognition of the moral truth of something, or a moral intuition is.
Well, now, conservatives, as I understand it, would blend would, in witnessing somebody beating up a girl over there in the corner, would oppose it as a result of a combination of factors. Number one is that somewhere along the line they were taught that this is something you shouldn't do. And number two, this tends to appeal to certain moral resources which we tend to believe, with Plato, are latently there, but are not necessarily awakened without some kind of a catalytic exercise.
Well, I'm not sure. You are being very brave about what conservatives would hold, because conservatives hold a great many different things about morality. Some of them are Burkeans about it. Some of them are like Hayek. Some of them are, as you describe, Platonists. The Straussians, for example, are more leaning toward Platonism. It's not too clear whether the conservatives have a philosophical background for their moral judgment in that case. I have not found one, as a matter of fact. And I read Modern Age and I read National Review, and you know the Jaffa and the Crystal and the Burns debates that you publish yourself. They all indicate a great disarray among conservatives as to where their moral principles come from or where their political principles come from, just among as among libertarians, as a matter of fact.
Well, they may disagree as to the provenance of those principles. They don't, I think, disagree about the defensibility of them. You would have, let's say, a human rights man like Strauss, spoken for by Jaffa, saying, human rights are intuited because human rights inhere in the metaphysics of human beings. You might have Irving Kristol say, well, human rights are discoverable as a result of every study of experience, the empirical approach. But they'd come out in the same position, wouldn't they?
I can't comment on that, because as a matter of fact, Irving Kristol's a neoconservative, not quite a conservative, so that bails him out from having to agree with any conservative, precisely. I do think there is a great deal of eclecticism there, probably even more than amongst the libertarians, because not only do the conservatives disagree on some of the background arguments or the ground for their political conclusions, but they very often disagree on just exactly what policy implications conservatism has. Very few people, well, some conservatives, if you can call them conservatives, would not like anything like the sort of censorship that Irving Kristol endorses. Mm-hmm. Some of them are not as principled in their opposition to state intervention as Harry Jaffa is. Jaffa is much more of a Lockean and a Thomist than, say, Burns and the other theoreticians in this movement. So I'm reluctant to classify the conservatives, because they are, I think, as a matter of fact, judging by, for example, George Will's columns, in principle against principles. They don't like principles very much. They think it's sort of artificial in human life to adhere to principles.
Well, for George here, I think he resists schematization, and he does admit rather more passively than I would the necessity from time to time to have vigorous state action. I think that's true. But you say you hesitate to generalize, and yet you wrote, conservatives tend in the main to be anti-rationalistic in their methodology.
There's an exception to some of the things I say.
I was wondering, when you say conservatives tend to be anti-rationalistic, do you mean it to the extent that they recognize the reality of tradition?
Not only that, but that they recognize the supremacy of tradition to reason.
Well, now, for instance, let's take the tradition of Jim Crow, which is certainly a tradition in the South for hundreds of years. Now, there are, I suppose, a few conservatives that you can point to.
Mel Bradford is one.
Well, Mel Bradford would have simply said that certain things that people say automatically about Jim Crow ought not to be said as a result of an empirical investigation of how it worked, right? Mm-hmm. But would he have said that because Jim Crow existed, therefore, the notion of human equality should be subordinated?
No, I don't think conservatives are even that closely or rigorously committed to tradition. I mean, I think they are very loose on all fronts in that respect. They are willing to move and adjust themselves, which in some respects is a kind of pragmatic attitude, and it's highly respected in this country by businessmen and by many people. In a way, they are part of the contemporary ethos in not sticking to anything very firmly when the chips are down, and that's a point of their pride, I think, in some ways. They're very adjustable.
Their resilience.
That's right.
Well, now, here you seem to want to distinguish between conservatives and libertarians. When you say libertarians, however, in the main, have a high regard for reason, suggesting we don't, for uncovering objective and true principles from which to derive subsidiary political and legal principles and infer various practical policy recommendations or prohibitions.
Yes, with some exceptions, I think that's true of many libertarian theorists. Now, there are those who are by some called libertarian theorists, for example, Hayek, of whom this would not be the case, although in clarification, I should say that Hayek identifies reason with a Cartesian notion of deliberative, monitored, rationalistic argument. Mm-hmm. And when you talk to Hayek and you say, well, what about Aristotelian reason? He draws back his anti-rationalistic and constructivist arguments and is more sympathetic to the efficacy of reason in these realms. But, for example, Ludwig von Mises is very much a Kantian and a rationalist. Even the empiricists, so-called empiricists of the Chicago school, tend in the main to be very much committed to reasoning and arguing and not worrying that much about history and that much about tradition. Though, I mean, all of these are rather general points, and that's why I said tend in the main in the conservative case, and the same thing in the libertarian case.
Well, how would you, using exclusively rationalist arguments, oppose, let's say, genocide, or well, let's use a softer word, euthanasia, exercised on those members of society, A, that contribute nothing to it, B, whose afflictions are in any case terminal, and C, whose impositions on that society are heavy.
You wouldn't allow the impositions. That's the only thing that you would probably, from a libertarian point of view, concern yourself with. You wouldn't go out and kill them, you wouldn't do anything, but you would not allow any impositions made in their behalf in the sense in which you would say be required to give up your life and your goals and your aspirations for the sake of these people. That's a now, you know, you ask a very large question for which probably a book is necessary to answer, whether this can be construed as a purely rationalist argument. I would suppose that what I mean by a rationalist argument is that you would have to take into consideration human nature. You would have to take into consideration such ontological issues as whether it's teleological or whether it's mechanistic, whether there is such a thing as moral purpose in life and in human life, and whether the moral purpose coincides with a kind of society in which these kinds of people, for example, would be treated in the way in which you suggest or in some other way. And that is the general schemata that one would have to go through and work through in order to arrive at the question, at the answer that you're asking. Now, to give that, to give the flesh and the bones to that schemata would be a very lengthy process. But I would just predict that what would arise from a libertarian examination is that no matter how destitute or how crippled or how unfortunate someone is, it does not entitle the person to a institutionalized, legalized system of extracting help from others. There are moral circumstances, desperate moral circumstances, in which I, who am not just a libertarian but also a human being with a moral framework, would maintain that it is perfectly okay for a person to, under those desperate circumstances, what you might call emergency cases, to engage in actions that are ordinarily outside the bounds of morality, and certainly outside the bounds of law. But as far as institutionalizing these emergency cases, it would be a tragic for society. And in fact, I think it has caused us to suffer considerably, because now practically half the government is built on emergency cases.
Well, let's say that you have a 75-year-old bachelor, and he's retired, he's living in a little apartment in New York, and one day, the cleaning woman who comes in once a week finds that he's just lying there, and he's apparently immobile. She asks him how he is. She says something's wrong with him. What is she supposed to do in a society that has not provided institutional means by which this person can be looked after?
Well, first of all, you have to build up the rest of that society. It may not have provided institutional or legal governmental means, but it may have provided a lot of other means. I mean, there are, even in our society, which is very largely dependent on government support, plenty of ways in which one can avoid that. I have avoided it most of the time when I have managed to go to some private schools and get some private funding in my educational support, and I haven't supported my education entirely. I've also used government money. But the fact is that you can always go to the Red Cross, you can always call a church, you can always call a charitable institution. And presumably, as libertarian society would also be a community, not just a legal system, in which all the normal, decent, and some indecent elements of human life would flourish. And under those circumstances that you describe, the cleaning woman would pick up the phone and maybe call somebody who is on record as helping just the sort of person that this bachelor happens to be.
In other words, you think it's safe to assume that sanctuaries for such people would grow up as readily in a totally libertarian society as in a society that, after all, used the same sentiments but channeled them through government?
Yes, exactly. I think that that's not an unfair assumption, especially when you consider that the welfare state is largely a democratic system.
Well, in the do you then distinguish at all between conservatives who really come to complementary conclusions with your own, if they come to those conclusions, or do you say that they're having arrived at those conclusions through a different methodology disqualifies them from the purity of the libertarian position?
No, I don't distinguish them. As a matter of fact, conclusions of the sort that libertarians have arrived at, if you arrive at them from any source whatsoever, I think qualifies you as a libertarian, mm-hmm. because it's a conclusion, that layer of political conclusions that matters. There are conservatives, as a matter of fact, who consider themselves conservative libertarians. President Reagan was interviewed in Reason magazine some years ago, and he called himself a libertarian conservative at the time. That was in 1975.
So do I.
I understand. And your debate with Galbraith at the Cambridge Union, where you defended the individualist tradition, mm-hmm. I wouldn't have disagreed with anything you said under the circumstances. Mm-hmm. I have seen Gary North write articles for National Review in which he defends local censorship, which, even though he is more of a libertarian sometimes than many other people, in that issue he's not a libertarian. So there are overlaps, there are fusionists. Frank Meyer was a person who very much tried to maintain a fusion between the more traditional conservatives of the European kind with American background to conserve, and the libertarians who are more purists. And we try to conserve that tradition to some extent.
Ms. Machan, let's turn to a critic of the libertarian movement, Mr. Professor Ernest Vandenhaag, a professor of law and jurisprudence, the Olin M. Chair at Fordham. Mr. Vandenhaag is well known to the viewers of this audience and author of a number of distinguished books and a provocative essayist and polemicist, Mr. Vandenhaag.
Let me start that I shall stipulate that Mr. Machan is not to be held responsible for the stupidities and sillinesses of the Libertarian Party, so I shall ask him purely philosophical questions. The first one is this, Mr. Machan, I think you were a little evasive when Mr. Buckley asked you about that 75-year-old bachelor. Let me change this slightly. Suppose there are a number of orphans in the society. They never had an opportunity to provide for their future. They were orphaned at the age of 2. They can obviously not provide them for themselves. And now let me make this assumption, which is not that unreasonable. For one reason or other, private charity is not sufficient, is not forthcoming to take care of them.
Yeah, either are not sufficient or not forthcoming.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Either. Are you maintaining that since you are bitterly opposed to government intervention, these orphans should be left to starve?
Notice I did not say that they should be left to starve. I would maintain that they should not be left to starve, but it doesn't follow from my maintaining that they should not be left to starve that the government should do anything about it. And in fact, I would oppose the government doing anything about it because it's not its business. Its business is to protect the rights of the people of the society from foreign aggression and from criminals. And anything else that needs to be done ought to be done by the people of the society.
You have not answered my question. I stipulated that there is no private
initiative. Then there will not be any help.
And no private help. So the only possibility is either government help or starvation. Are you opting for starvation?
Yes, as a matter of fact.
Thank you.
Now, before you continue, because obviously this sounds like a great touche. Now, let me just respond a little bit. Almost any political system can be asked that kind of a question with the stipulations of the sort that you made. For example, the Federal Communication Commission or the FTC or the Health and Welfare Department goes bankrupt. It hasn't got any money. I stipulate that. Now let's see how we help unwed mothers. We can't, and they starve. So we have a system in the welfare state very similar to the one that you've just outlined about the libertarian society. I think both of them are totally unrealistic, but nevertheless, if you do push me that way, that's the case.
I let that pass. The orphan case, unfortunately, is not unrealistic. It did happen historically. Ask you, so many societies, including medieval societies and so on.
Well, not, you're not talking about
not libertarian society. Hmm?
You're not talking about America.
Oh, no. That's not the spot. Let me ask you a more philosophical question. You said correctly that you count some utilitarians, such as Friedrich von Hayek, among libertarians. What I'm curious about is, if I understand libertarianism, the basic principle is that liberty is the supreme principle. You do seem to reject, say, John Rawls' idea that justice should be the supreme principle of society. You do seem to reject all kinds of other things. You seem to think that liberty is not only necessary, but also sufficient in some sense as governmental principle. Now, my question is this. If you are utilitarian, as Hayek is, you feel that the basic purpose of social organization is happiness. If you are libertarian, on the other hand, if I understand you, you must feel that it is liberty. The two can often be in conflict. If you think, for instance, of Dostoevsky's Grand Inquisitor, the whole point of that chapter was to point out that happiness and liberty may be in conflict with one another. They needn't be, but they could be. How can you then count people such as Hayek or Milton Friedman, both of whom are utilitarians, among the libertarians?
Well, first, just a caution. I don't know that Friedrich Hayek or Milton Friedman would call themselves utilitarians. Just put that on the record.
I'm not sure they would either.
I doubt that very seriously. You want to call them utilitarians. But there are utilitarians, such as Posner, who is a utilitarian, who happen to argue that as a matter of empirical evidence and historical evidence, the greatest happiness of the greatest number, or the general welfare, is best achieved within the confines or the framework of a free market and a strictly free market economy. Now, once in a while, in cases of good Samaritanism of the sort that we have touched on already, they might make an exception, but not an institutional exception. They might make an exception for an individual to act in a certain way which is in contradiction to some libertarian principle, perhaps, but not institutionally. They don't want to become rule utilitarians of the sort that contradict libertarian principles. Now, I'm talking about those utilitarians who happen to have this conviction. Another one is Bob Cunningham at the University of San Francisco. So there are libertarians who argue for liberty on the basis of its greatest efficiency for providing for the general welfare.
Let me ask the same question of Mr. Buckley. Let me reformulate it slightly to make it impossible for you to avoid it as Mr. Machan did. He avoided it by simply saying liberty is necessarily conducive to happiness and so on, which may be the case. I think Milton Friedman, for instance, thinks so largely. So do I, for that matter. But the intellectual question still is, as asked by the Grand Inquisitor, suppose it is not. Which of the two would you think is more important or should be pursued by society whenever there is a choice?
I think the society has got to stand as available when there is a failure in the private sector to attend to rudimentary human needs. I believe in the doctrine of subsidiarity. But as you may remember, Hayek has no objection to social welfare laws, mm-hmm. provided certain very, very important procedures are followed in creating them.
No, nor do I, for that matter. But Hayek, unlike Mr. Machan, I think, believes in tradition and spontaneous order. And I would regard him as much more of a conservative than as a libertarian. And that was what my question aimed at.
Although he goes to great lengths to disavow conservatism in an important chapter in an important book.
Yes, he does, but he doesn't understand what he's disavowing. It's a different matter.
Yeah, if you call conservatism Whiggism, then he says, all right.
let me turn to a different question, which I'd like to address to Mr. Machan. Don't you think that there is an element of excessive rationalism in what you define as libertarianism, almost a utopian rationalism? For instance, you assume that those social expenses that are necessary. You implied when answering Mr. Buckley before, for instance, that military expenditures in the present world situation are unavoidable. You supported them. How should they be defrayed, if not by taxation? By charging the seamstress that Mr. Buckley mentioned some sort of fee for her contracts? Wouldn't that put the whole weight of taxation on people who happen to have to make contracts and not on people who, for one reason or other, we think in fairness ought to pay taxes?
I believe in the trickle-down theory of contract fees. I think it would trickle down. The market would probably impose on everyone a sort of quote-unquote fair share. But your question probably ought to have been asked, like, am I a utopian rather than an extreme rationalist? Because I'm not a utopian. I do not believe any of this is guaranteed. I think people have to go out and work for it and argue for it and do whatever it is necessary for citizens to bring this thing about. So I don't know why rationalism is here equated with a kind of pie in the sky expectation of the world, as if automatically these things would happen. I think this requires community citizen action. This requires for people to, first of all, see the point of the libertarian alternative, then act on it, and act on it constantly, and not just go to bed and say, well, now we have made our case, we've written a nice book, we have organized a nice party, we'll go to sleep, and tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, we'll have everything hunky-dory in the society. I think this is a constant activity by members of a society, a polis, in the Aristotelian tradition, to sustain a commonwealth. And that's the way I envision a libertarian world, not in the way in which I think you imply, that somehow by putting certain kinds of institutional schemas into the structure, things will grow out automatically. The way some free enterprises believe that if you just have a free market, everything will happen automatically. And I don't hold that view.
I think you defended yourself very ably against a charge I never made. So I'll go
well,
to that point.
I don't know
point.
What rationalism means then under your definition.
It means this, you see. I think that if a society is to function, in addition to proper laws and so on, we need to foster a spirit of mutual solidarity, identification, if you wish, compassion. Now, I know you're not opposed to any of these things, but the question is, how would a libertarian society foster these things? Now, we foster them at the present time through certain institutions. We make even certain laws.
They're not compulsory institutions, are they?
Some of them are. You see, my view is that these things that we all three think are desirable, are unlikely to happen unless there is a certain sharing of values. And that sharing of values ultimately has to be protected by some compulsory institutions. For instance, we prohibit necrophilia action. In other words, you cannot legally try to go to a cemetery and have intercourse with the dead. We prohibit, or try to, certain forms of...
Would that be a victimless crime?
According to Mr. Machan, it would be. That's my point.
Why don't you ask me before you say
I will ask you in just a moment.
You've invaded the cemetery, so it would be trespassing, number one, right?
Suppose it is...
That's not a victimless crime.
No, the dead have no juridical personality, but let that go. If I understand you correctly, you would not object to pornography of all kinds being permitted.
Permitted? I might object to pornography of a lot of kinds.
Well, sure, but you would object to any sort of legal inhibition of that pornography. I think you would generally, as far as I understand you would abolish libel laws. In short, you would abolish all those institutions which, in a sense, try to protect our ability to share values with one another.
Well, that's your way.
That is what I meant. Yes, it is my way of putting it. Of course, I leave it to you to put it in your way. That is, of course.
Would you require schooling?
Require compulsory education?
I'm trying to think of something that is compulsory, that is institution. And
yes,
the only thing
I
think of offhand is schools.
Yes.
You got to go to school.
No, I wouldn't compel anybody to go to school. I think that's a very bad idea. I think it's been a total failure. I think people have the illusion that they're educated and they think that they can read advertisements and that gives them a sense of erudition. I think it's a fraud. It's a total fraud.
To say that our education hasn't been good enough is not to say that we're worse off than if we didn't have any.
No, but I think there is ample evidence from the writings of someone, for example, as E.G. West and Samuel Blumenfeld and so on, to indicate that not only is it a violation of principle, but it's also a very bad idea to coerce education and to finance it publicly.
Well, suppose, as you know, there are societies where most people are illiterate and so on and so on. Now, I certainly agree with you that I wouldn't brag about our educational system. Nonetheless, don't you think it would be likely that if there were no compulsory education, some parents would simply not send their children to school, and some children would not volunteer to school? They would grow up not only illiterate, but generally being unable, so to speak, to share the social values which your school badly enough is meant to transmit. But you would not compel them, would you?
No, I wouldn't. And one of the reasons that I think that there is nothing wrong with my frame of reference and my framework as a result of that lack that you point out is that I don't know of any alternative system in which the kind of utopian vision that I think your question assumes is desirable has been realized or can be realized. In which everybody is brought into the mold in a kind of a happy sharing of values. This doesn't happen in America today. It doesn't happen in the Soviet Union. It doesn't happen anywhere that I know of. And political systems, like scientific systems, I think have to be evaluated comparatively, not on the basis of some ideal model to which nothing is capable of adhering would you mind living up to? It's impossible.
I would apply this maxim to libertarianism.
That's right. It's comparatively.
But I'm comparing it not with an ideal model of our society, but with what we actually have, a pretty bad schooling system, etc., etc. Yet most people become literate. Under your system, I'm not sure. It is quite conceivable that, and here is where we might disagree philosophically, one of the tasks of society, it seems to me, is to protect those who cannot easily protect themselves. Children, say, that are not treated well by their parents. Parents who treat their children well probably will send them to school or teach them themselves, etc., etc. But there are some children whose parents may not treat them well or who may be indifferent to their welfare. If I understand you correctly, there's nothing much that society or the government should do about it.
You don't understand me correctly with respect to that, because there is a nuance of libertarianism, again not worked out in great detail, having to do with the rights of children, contractual or special rights that they have because of the circumstances under which they were born and the circumstances of being young human beings. They are incapable of making judgments and taking actions on their own accord, that parents are obligated and can be legally coerced to provide some kind of basic support given the context of the society.
Would that not include education?
I'm not absolutely sure whether it would require the kind of education that Dr. Vandenhaag has in mind. It may require them, for example, to acquaint them with the world, so to speak, so that they become operative citizens or operative human beings when they grow up. And if the children have been neglected, various agencies could institute legal suits about this. It's already happening now. When they get bad education, sometimes they go back and sue the school. Something along those lines on the not on a preventive level, but on the retaliatory level, libertarianism allows for. Now, it hasn't worked it out, and I can't give you a nice schemata of how this would work, but I think that there are provisions that would at least, how should I say, satisfy some of your concerns, which, by the way, I think are legitimate concerns. I don't think just because there is no government coercive mechanism to pretend to actually solve them, and I would have to emphasize this pretense, because I don't think they solve any of these things. Even literacy isn't a panacea. I do think, however, that in a libertarian society, institutional and even legal arrangements would emerge that, without violating the essential autonomy of adult individuals, would solve these problems.
Here's the point. You've become, in the progress of this discussion, more and more reasonable. But to become more and more reasonable, you also have abandoned more and more libertarian principles. Because what you are really now saying is, if I understand you correctly, that we will coerce parents some way or other to take care of their children.
Yeah, I don't see why it's inherent in libertarianism that there is an obligation if you have a child.
I don't either, but yeah. It is.
I don't
see why it's inherent in the doctrine of libertarianism that if you have a child, you owe it anything. I think you owe it anything, but I don't think libertarianism says you do.
Well, as you probably have read in various tracts on libertarianism, it hasn't been spelled out. However, in my book, Human Rights and Human Liberties, I do make allusions to the contention, at least, that there is a tacit, implicit, or explicit promise, an obligation that ensues when a person undertakes acts the results of which happen to be children, or at least could be children. And that is a way in which one can bring about a obligation which is legally enforceable because there are other human beings involved and they have claims to values that ensue.
You've got a Pandora's box here, doesn't he? Has a Pandora's box?
Oh, yes, indeed.
I don't think
he's
I do.
He's just given up libertarianism,
right.
As far as I can understand.
Well, that's your judgment, but I think that's just refining it and making it more
workable. It's no longer atomistic.
No. It seems to me that if I understand it, it involves the absence of government compulsion.
That's right.
Those obligations that you and I have just recognized.
These
but
are
you
retaliatory.
Have just admitted government compulsion into it, so you are no longer a libertarian.
But this is not
compulsion.
I wish
to congratulate you.
I mean, but you see, I don't agree with you that this is compulsion, because what this is a retaliation to the violation of an obligation,
well, why
which
can't
is always recognized as the government job to protect people against.
Why can't they retaliate against you for publishing Lady Chatterley's Love on?
Because that's not an aggressive act, whereas the violation of a contract is an aggressive
act. But then
act.
It becomes a political matter of what's an aggressive act. Oh, my goodness, we have to stop. Mr. Tibor Machan, thank you very much, the editor of the Libertarian Reader. Professor Ernest Vandenhaag of Fordham University. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Funding for this program was provided by this station, by other public television stations, and by the following. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content.